Good morning, and welcome to worship with the community of First United Methodist Church, where we believe every person is a beloved child of God on a journey to God with God. I'm Kathy Stone, associate pastor, and my pronouns are she, her. As I highlight a few announcements, I invite you to remember that we are gathered by the power of the Holy Spirit, so greet the community either in the chat or by leaving a comment. First, it's almost time for back to school, which we all know is still being decided on and planned, and we know it's going to look very different this year. But we know as well that God is present through all of it. We have some ways to bless the work of education in our community. First, do you work in a school? Are you a teacher? Any kind of educator? Custodial staff working in the cafeteria. We want to know who in our congregation is connected with the school, so send us your name. We have a link on the website to do that so that we can be praying for each of you as this new school year begins. And second, we want your help praying for the schools across the community. We all have at least one or two or more schools in our neighborhoods. Head down the street and say a prayer there for the students, the teachers, the staff, and then take a picture, take a selfie or take a picture of each other there in front of the school and email that to devin@fumcaustin.org. We want to put something together that will show the layers of prayers that have been prayed across the community. So we hope you will join us with that. We have a prayer that you are welcome to use on the website, or you can pray your own. Let's join together now between today and August 16th to gather those pictures, to drive by your campuses and send those our way. All of these details are available on our website. And then this week, it's Pride Week here in Austin. Normally at this time, we would be preparing our float for the parade that should be happening next Saturday. But of course, all of the Pride festivities have been canceled for this year. But that doesn't mean that Pride is canceled. Today in worship, we're celebrating Pride, and for the rest of the week, we invite you to join with us and join others across the community to paint our neighborhoods in rainbows. We even have a video that we'll be sharing that has been produced by members of our church and other Austin area welcoming and affirming churches. And we would love for you to share that affirming message on your own social media. So let's join together. Let's celebrate Pride. Decorating our yards, balcony, windows, social media. We can't wait to see your pictures online. We love and affirm each and every one of you. We love you. God loves you. And now, as the gathered community, as we enter into worship, let us join in our response. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord.
To the God who cannot die, I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
To the one who hears me cry, I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
To the God of the oppressed, I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
To the God of all justice, I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord. In all the good times, through all the bad times, I say yes, my Lord, to every word you speak. For the dream I have today, I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
To be a healer of all pain. I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
To come to love my enemies. I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
For your peace in all the world. I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord.
I say yes, my Lord, in all the good times, through all the bad times. I say yes, my Lord, to every word you speak.
Please join me in our call to worship. With friends and strangers, with family and neighbors, we gather. Come among us, healing God. With that love which never ends, with faith reaching out to touch, with hearts straining to trust, we hope. Come among us, friend of the broken, with your compassion which makes us whole, with word and wonder, with silence and song, we wait. Come among us, dryer of our tears, to lift us to our feet to follow you.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, your mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above,
join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love.
Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, in your mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Pardon of our sin and our peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide.
Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside.
Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Join your hearts with mine in prayer. Maker of covenants, as we draw close to you this morning, remind us of the promises that bind us. Remind us of your great faithfulness and love for us, and fill us with the same. Though the difficulties of today are heavy on our hearts, we know that our lives are full of your blessings. Renew our spirits, Lord, and refresh our sight that our very lives may become an act of worship. Amen. Today we are celebrating Pride Week in Austin, and while we are so disappointed that we're not able to do it upright in the way that we usually do with the Pride Parade and various festivities, we wanted to make sure that we took some time to just to celebrate the LGBTQ presence in our midst as part of our church community and the broader LGBTQ community in Austin. And so we've put together this wonderful video of Pride's past as our sort of virtual parade. So we hope you enjoy this celebration of Pride.
Please join me in our prayer for illumination. Guide us, O God, by your word and Holy Spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our reading today is from Philemon. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother. Let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church. I'm Taylor First. My pronouns are she and her, and I'm the senior pastor of First United Methodist Church of Austin. I'm so glad that you're joining us for worship today. For these first 3 weeks in August, we are focused on the meaning and the work of blessing, how there are these things in our lives that are a blessing to us, things that are positive, that are gifts of grace in our lives. They could be anything. It may be your job, your family, the home that you live in. It could be 1,000 other small things, things like your ability to garden or your really vivacious energy, or you have extra long arms, or you have a great knack for style. So many things that are a blessing in your life, something that you see as a gift in your life that you didn't really come by on your own, but that God had some role in. So you may say, well, I worked really hard to earn this degree. And that's really true. There are a lot of blessings that God invites us to partner on. So we have some part in that blessing in our lives. But we can also look at it and say, God is in this. I could not have done this all on my own. Beginning in Genesis and then scattered all throughout the rest of Scripture, we learn that these blessings are not really meant to sit in our little private trophy cases. God tells Abram, I will bless you, and you will be a blessing to all the world. So we have discovered this link between the blessings that we receive in our lives and the blessings that we share with others. The gift that we receive and the call to give really cannot be separated. It was just this week, Reverend Ann Fields reminded me of this quote from Emerson that said, the talent is the call, right? Those things are connected. Last week, we talked specifically about the gifts, the things that we have that bless us and that God calls us to use to bless others. So that would be like our church saying, you know, we have this building or these buildings that stand a block away from the Texas State Capitol. I wonder if there is any way that we can use those to bless others. And then as a result of considering that blessing, we start to bless others by allowing them to use our space as a staging ground for visiting their legislators. We take this blessing and then we use it to bless others. So this week and next week as well, we're going beyond just our stuff, beyond these tangible things that God calls us to use as blessings. This week, we're talking about how we are blessed with influence and how we can use that influence to then bless others. So that would be more like saying, I am a pastor. And so I have a microphone at my disposal each week. And that means that more often than not, my legislator may care a little bit more about my opinion since I have some power, some voice in this community. So I'm going to use that influence on behalf of someone else. I'm going to take my pastor voice and all of the influence that goes with that, and I'm going to go advocate for the rights of the trans community or the Muslim community or someone else that I am called to serve. I'm going to leverage that influence for someone else's benefit because God has called me to use this blessing of influence to go and bless others. So for our scripture reading today, I chose this passage from the Apostle Paul's letter to Philemon. And the reality is, I could have chosen any one of a dozen different passages from Paul. He is just a master at this whole concept. Maybe it's Paul's training as an expert in the law and in the use of rhetoric. But again and again in his letters, Paul shows that he is keenly aware of the influence that he has with certain groups of people. He knows who might listen to him more because of his training, and who might value his thoughts more because of his devout Jewish background. Paul's call was to go from place to place throughout the entire region of the Roman Empire and to share with complete strangers what it is that God has done and is doing through this Jesus of Nazareth. So he was smart enough to know that in each place where he went, he had to ask, why would any of these people listen to me? He had to wonder, who is most likely to listen to me? Who do I have some influence with? Let me start there, and then we'll grow this movement from there. Paul was just a master at leveraging his influence for the sake of sharing this good news that God is redeeming all the world through the life and death and resurrection of Jesus. So in Philemon, we find Paul directly using his influence in order to change a person's life. While he was in prison in Rome, keep in mind that prison at that time and in that place was kind of more like house arrest, if you can imagine that. So in that time, Paul has connected with Onesimus. Onesimus is a slave in the household of Philemon. And Paul knows Philemon from kind of the old days. Paul probably helped to start a church in Philemon's house. So we don't know whether Onesimus escaped and came to Paul for help, or maybe if Philemon actually sent Onesimus to go and to assist Paul while he was in prison. We're not really sure how he came to be there with Paul. But in their time together in Rome, Paul has helped Onesimus to come to know this good news of Jesus Christ. That's why he says that he has become Onesimus's father. Onesimus has become a follower of Christ under the mentorship and the leadership of Paul. So now Paul is sending him back to Philemon with the hopes that Philemon will receive him back, not as a slave, but as a brother in Christ. Paul is urging Philemon to live out the words that he had written in the letter to the Galatians when he said, there is no longer Jew or Greek, there is no longer slave or free, there is no longer male or female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. Philemon has heard Paul preach this. Maybe he has even preached it himself. But now Paul challenges him to live it out in a tangible and maybe very costly way. Paul is using this influence to enact this whole life change for Onesimus. But he knows that this change will actually mean a life change for Philemon too. So he puts his full weight into it. He reminds Philemon, the master, that Philemon himself owes Paul a great debt as the one who led him to his own newfound faith. Paul is not just Onesimus's father in faith, he's Philemon's as well. In my favorite part, Paul says, I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. So let me give you the Taylor First translation of that. I pray that you will realize that people will really start listening to you when you actually practice what you preach. Paul is giving it everything he's got. He's putting the full weight of his influence into this effort to free Onesimus. But he's doing it for the sake of both of these men. He knows that it will change both of them. This is how Paul is just a master at this. He knows how to use himself as a vessel to accomplish something greater, to bless the lives of others. So what about you? What influence do you have? Who listens to you? I know. We all like to joke and to say, well, nobody listens to me, especially not my kids. But you know that's not really true. You have influence. We all have more influence than we often realize when we take the time to make our voices heard with our lawmakers. but we have to actually do it. And even beyond that kind of public advocacy, most of us are in conversations every day with someone who listens to us. Someone who finds your thoughts and your opinions important. That is a blessing. That is something you carry with you, the power of influence. So who will you use it for? How will that influence become a lever to bless someone? In this age of social media and personal branding, how will you use yourself as a vessel to get someone's attention about something larger than just your own ego? I'll tell you a couple of ways that I've been thinking about this week. First, many of us have had our eyes opened lately more to the privilege that we carry with us every day. And I'm talking about white privilege here. For so many, that understanding and that revealing is so quickly followed by guilt. But the purpose of understanding our white privilege is not to make us feel guilty about it. We understand it and how it works so that we can then use it to do some good, to identify racism with other white people and to undercut its effects. We take that white privilege and we use it to change things. So that's one way. The second one is this. This week is Pride Week in Austin, as Pastor Kathy told us earlier. It's a time when we usually gather together on a Saturday night and we dress in our finest rainbow wear and carry our church banner across the Capitol lawn, and we stand around and wait for 4 hours in the August heat to start a parade that will lead us among thousands of faces who appreciate every single float that goes by in that parade, but for whom it means so much more for the church, for Christians, to celebrate pride. We recognize that when the church speaks up and raises up the beauty and blessing of queer lives, we have the power to influence others. We have the power to bless those who are still hiding in churches of their own. We have the power to apologize and to begin the process of healing among those that we ourselves have hurt. God uses us to change the hearts of those who are afraid to accept or to welcome or to affirm. Our voice as a church, your voice as a Christian, matters to the lives of LGBTQIA people. We are called to speak up, to offer this blessing of our influence. Friends, you have been blessed. You have been blessed with so many things. Today, I want you to remember that you have been blessed with influence. Remember that that blessing comes with a call. And I pray that you will have the creative vision of God's Spirit to see new ways to answer that call and to use your influence to bless others. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
During the next few minutes, we will gather our prayer requests to offer up to God. As you listen to the music, we invite you to reflect on the prayers that you are lifting up today. And if you'd like, share those in the chat or comments on the screen. Let us go to God in prayer.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love.
Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy.
O Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul.
Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive,
and in dying that we're born to eternal life.
As we pray, please join in the following response. Blessed is the one who builds the Lord's kingdom. Teach us your ways, O Christ. Loving Creator, your kingdom is a blessing to all who know its ways and to all those who have been loved by one who does. From the moment that you breathed life and spirit into humanity, we have been marked by the grace of your love and likewise by our inability to love as you do. As we pray together this morning, draw us into your presence, into that overwhelming love that we are constantly striving after and seeking to live into. Remind us that to build your kingdom in the world, we must cultivate it also in ourselves. Blessed is the one who builds the Lord's kingdom. Teach us your ways, O Christ. Beloved Christ, we live in unfamiliar days, characterized by waiting, watching, hoping. At times, we feel your presence keenly, and it is a balm to our troubled hearts. At others, we can scarcely find you beneath the worries and cares that surround us. Calm our turbulent spirits and quiet our anxious minds. Remind us of the love we share for one another and for you. Fill us with the breath of your spirit and renew our senses so that we begin to see you in new ways and to find you in new places until all of creation echoes with the hymns of your wonderful kingdom. Blessed is the one who builds the Lord's kingdom. Teach us your ways, O Christ. Divine Spirit, as we enter into Pride Week, we rejoice especially for the lives and loves of all our LGBTQ siblings in Christ. We confidently and wholly affirm their lives and relationships, and we celebrate the gift of working alongside them to build and grow your kingdom in this world. But even as we celebrate, Lord, we long for a day when all of your churches welcome and rejoice in the diversity of your creation. We pray that you would be at work in our hearts so that we and all your creation might become whole and new. We pray that you would teach us to love more and better so that all the church and all the world might be joined into one holy community. no longer divided by the differences of our mortal bodies, but united in your holy and eternal spirit, and by our shared stake in your very image. Blessed is the one who builds the Lord's kingdom. Teach us your ways, O Christ. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, who put on the flesh to teach us the ways of the Spirit, and who taught us himself to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We are on a journey together here at First Church, a journey to God, with God, and it's a journey we make together. And today we celebrate that we have new folks who want to walk that journey together as a part of this church community and are ready to join the church today. And so I'm going to hand off to Trevor Harper, our Director of Connections, and we're going to have our very first ever virtual reception of new members.
Good morning, church. Thank you so much. I'm Trevor Harper, Director of Connections, and it has been a minute since I have stood before you in person or even virtually. We've got a very exciting group here today, an entirely new group of folks who are joining FUMC. So I'm so excited to introduce to you today, and I'll introduce them all by name. They can give you a quick wave, and then we're going to hear a little bit from them in this virtual world. It's a chance for you to get to know them just a little bit, but we are so excited today to welcome Catherine Clark. Charlotte Chu is here today. Hello! Cindy Walter, of course, you know, is joining us today to help with the congregational portion. Henry and Betsy Joyner. Adam and Meredith Wooderson. Of course, Reese, Jack, and Finn are running around there somewhere in the house. And Ellie Coleman are joining us today. Hello, everybody. We're so glad that you guys are here today. We just wanted to give the congregation an opportunity to get to know you a little bit, since we won't have that traditional opportunity to shake hands and meet and greet in the narthex. So we just have a couple of questions we wanted to kind of toss out to you today, and I'm going to go in any random order. I'll start with our friends, the Woodersons, very familiar faces also around FUMC. What drew you to First United Methodist Church of Austin? And now that you are joining in an official capacity, what do you hope that this church family brings to you and your faith story?
Yeah, thanks, Trevor. I think the first thing that struck us about First Church, the first time we attended, was just how welcoming everyone was, the church and the community. You know, we were looking for a new church community, and just moving past that part, what we really like is the inclusivity and the activism. And that's what we want from the church community, is to help us be more active in our faith, in the church, and in our community, and to help us raise our boys in that spirit as well.
Wonderful, guys. Thank you so much. We're so glad you're here. Another very, very familiar face around FUMC. Charlotte, we're going to jump right to you. I think anybody who has been at church in the past many years has seen your wonderful face, especially involved in the Christmas Eve breakfast. That's one of my favorite memories with you. But Charlotte, it's great to see you. What drew you, though I think we may have a partial answer to that one, to FUMC? And what are you hoping to achieve here?
Hi, good morning, all. So again, my name is Charlotte Chu. My sister is Doyce Myers, so that's how I got involved. For years and years and years, we would help out with the Christmas breakfast. And so something that draws me to this church is just the inclusiveness and the encouragement to explore doubts and faith and different points of view together. So I've kind of had a change in my worldview the last, I don't know, 15 years, 10 years. So there's a lot of churches that it's hard to go to. But I appreciate First Church and just, the inclusiveness and encouragement to explore different points of view together, and that it's a safe place to do that. So I guess that's, you know, one of the reasons I'm becoming a member, because I want to make that action step to say I'm part of this community, even though, like, unofficially I've been a part for several years. So I guess I feel like it's going to be a place and a community that can help me out of a rut and kind of give me a place to give back, so that I'm not staying stagnant and in my selfishness, but a place to remind me that we're in it together, we're exploring life together, weird stuff comes up, but it's a safe place to explore those different situations and changes of view and things like that. So.
Excellent. We're so happy. That's what it's all about, isn't it? I guess we're just what they say. We're making it official, though. You've been a part of the family for some time. Thank you so much, Charlotte. Catherine, good morning to you, and thanks for joining us. How about you? What drew you to this church family, and what are you hoping to live out here?
Hi, good morning. For me, I had gone and attended other churches, but when I first went to FUMC Austin, I felt like I belonged there, whereas other places I felt like I fit in, but I just felt a great sense of belonging and welcoming. And just like the Wooderton said, and Charlotte has said, it's a very welcoming place to be, very infectious atmosphere. And my hope is that what I expect to get out of being a member here is to strengthen my faith in the community, but also to help do that with others.
Thank you so much, Catherine. Yeah, that's what it's all about. And we hope to be changed by you guys as well. Ellie, good morning to you. Thank you for being here. Introduce yourself to our wonderful congregation and touch those 2 points for us as well.
Morning, I'm Ellie. I moved to Austin and I was looking for an affirming space that was justice oriented. So I found FUMC on the internet and I came and visited and just really warmly welcomed. So I'm just really excited to have a congregation and a community. And thanks for having me.
It is our pleasure. Thank you for being here, for sure. We're happy to welcome you, Ellie. And last but certainly not least, Henry and Betsy Joyner, good morning to you. Would you like to tell the congregation a bit about you?
Good morning. Our daughter and son-in-law are members, and we visited with them and we felt very welcomed, and we like to be a part of our grandson's faith journey, and we just felt very we like the acceptance of the church and the missions and what else,
and the things we hope to be a part of that have been important to us in all of the churches that we belong to are a chance for some small group explorations of faith and issues like systemic racism, but also an opportunity to learn more about what the needs of the neighbors are around the church and be a part of the ministries that reach out to them.
That's wonderful, and I hope that we're able to, you guys heard that small group, so if you're out there and you think they'd be a great fit for yours, definitely scoop them up. And of course, we're talking about their family, Sarah and Anthony Gutierrez, or whom they're speaking, a little griffin, of course, are your kin. That is so wonderful. Thank you all so very, very much for being here. It's great to learn a little bit more about you.
Okay, and now welcome. This is so exciting. So glad y'all are here and taking this step into membership. And we are just thrilled to have y'all here with us. I'm going to ask you a few questions, these historic questions of faith. So here we go. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do.
I do.
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do.
I do.
I do.
According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? If so, say, I will.
I will.
And now, having affirmed your faith, I ask you to make these vows of membership in the church. As members of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, say, I will.
I will.
I will.
As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, say, I will.
I will.
Now, Cindy, as a leader in our congregation, you are here to represent and to lead the congregation in welcoming these wonderful new friends into our family. So I ask you, and along with you, all of the congregation, members of the household of God, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you in your care? If so, say, we will.
We will.
Then I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. Together with you, we will form a community of love and forgiveness. We will proclaim God's good news and live according to the example of Christ. As members, together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
Excellent. Now, everybody at home in your Zoom room, on Facebook and YouTube, wherever you're watching, if you will please give our new members a huge round of applause for joining FUMC Austin. We are so very excited to have you all here. And as we've said before, this is not the end of the journey. It's the very beginning. Even though we can't shake hands in the narthex, I encourage you guys, especially on Zoom, to jump in and maybe shoot them a direct message in the chat and let them know how FUMC has impacted your life and maybe some ways that you think it would be great for them to get involved. We're so happy to have you guys here. Thank you for joining us.
What a blessing it is to receive these folks into our community. Welcome to each one of you. We're so excited that you're here. Friends, we need community. We're made for it, and it has never been more important than it is now. If you're interested in being a part of this community of faith, what I like to call Jesus's merry band of troublemakers here at First Church, I hope that you will make sure to fill out our online connection card so that we can help you to get plugged into the ministry of this church. In the meanwhile, I want to express my gratitude for the way that all of you have continued to practice such incredible generosity over these weeks throughout the pandemic. These are times when all of the learning and the formation and the growth in faith really comes to full fruition. When things in our world get scary and we are faced with challenges, and we respond by persistently shining light into that darkness, giving ourselves away, even in the face of uncertainty, following that example of Christ. So thank you for giving in order to continue the life-changing ministry of this church. Just a reminder that you can give by simply mailing a check into the church office. The mail still works, and the church office will still receive those. You can give online just by going to fumcaustin.org, and you'll find a button there to give online. You can also give by text, and you'll see the instructions for that in just a moment on your screen. Now, as we prepare to make these offerings to God today, I invite you to join your hearts with mine in prayer. O God, among this community gathered by your Spirit, we remember that the well-being of all life is interconnected. In all that we do, help us turn from individualism and self-sufficiency and practice solidarity with one another in joy and struggle. Give us grace to share what we have, strive for collective freedom, and give and receive in mutual love, so that we might honor God's intentions for life and create openings for the flourishing that we desire. This prayer and these offerings, we give them in faith. Amen.
Sign me up,
sign me up
for the Christian Jubilee.
Write my name,
write my name on that roll,
on heaven's roll,
for I've been changed.
I've been changed
since the Lord has lifted me.
I want to be
ready when Jesus comes.
When Jesus comes,
when Jesus comes,
oh, the trumpet will sound loud
when my Savior comes.
When my Savior comes,
all the saints in Christ shall rise. Oh, I'm glad I've been changed since he lifted me.
I want to be
ready when Jesus comes.
Sign me up,
sign me up
for the Christian Jubilee.
Write my name,
write my name on that roll,
on heaven's roll,
for I've been changed.
I've been changed
since the Lord has lifted me.
I want to be
ready when Jesus comes.
You know not the day,
nor the hour
he shall appear,
but we know in our hearts
that he's coming back again.
My heart is fixed and my mind's made up.
I want to be ready when Jesus comes.
Sign me up,
sign me up
for the Christian Jubilee.
Write my name,
write my name on that roll,
on heaven's roll,
for I've been changed.
I've been changed
since the Lord has lifted me.
I want to be ready when Jesus comes.
I want to be
ready when Jesus comes.
In days like these, it can be so hard to have hope. Our closing hymn is a prayer and a reminder that God is the one who gives us hope, and God is unfailing in that gift. God gives us hope and joy and peace and so many other gifts and blessings. So let's sing together, Lord of all hopefulness.
At the break of the day.
Lord of all kindliness, Lord of all grace, your hands swift to welcome, your arms to embrace.
Be there at our homing and give us, we pray, love in our hearts, Lord, at the eve of the day.
Lord of all gentleness, Lord of all calm, whose voice is contentment, whose
presence is balm.
Be there at our sleeping, and give us, we pray, your peace in our hearts, Lord, at the end of the day.
Now, as we go into this new week, join me in blessing one another with our benediction. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you, wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Amen.